Good morning, all of you, including the honorable judges who are present here, judges from opposite courts, senior counsels, and all the advocates, especially the junior members of the bar. A hearty welcome to the webinar. And the resource person of the day is one of the very famous lawyer from Chennai, Srinal Raja, is a designated senior advocate at Madras High Court. He enrolled himself in the year 1986, and his practice commenced under the one of the greatest advocates of India, Mr. Govind Swaminathan. He was also the former Advocate General of Tamil Nadu. Mr. Raja has a very extensive exposure in the fields of writ jurisdiction, original site, drafting and conveyancing, arbitration, consumer protection laws, and energy laws that include Electricity Act. And Mr. Raja is the former president of Madras Consumer Courts Bar Association, and is a former trustee and currently the advisor of the Citizen, Consumer and Civic Connection Group, and dedicates himself in the matter of creating awareness among the consumers of their rights and other things. And in the year 2000, Mr. Raja was invited to the United States by the government to the International Visitorship Program. And he also participated in the year 2013 in the deliberation of the United Nations conference called the UNCITRAL at the biggest of UNO. And more importantly, Mr. Raja has co-opted by Justice D.P. Wadhwa, former Supreme Court judge, which submitted a report to the Supreme Court about the public distribution system in Tamil Nadu. Mr. Raja is also the founding director of Nani Palkiwala Arbitration Center, which you know that the center recognized by the Madras High Court in the matter of rendering assistance to arbitration matters. Mr. Raja was also a member of the committee formed by the Law Commission of India to suggest amendments to the Arbitration Conciliation Act. And adding more feathers to the cap, Mr. Raja has co-authored a book called Consumer Protection India with Justice D.P. Wadhwa, published by Wadhwa Publications. And if I omit to say anything about the Heritage Committee of the Madras High Court, I'm omitting an important history chapter in the history of Madras High Court. Mr. Raja has written a wonderful book called A 150-Year Journey from a Crown's Court to the People's Court. And the book is about the Madras High Court and not to be missed one. Another book authored by Mr. Raja throws a limelight on the architectural moral, what is called the architectural marvel and value of the Madras High Court building. And the book is titled An Iconic Splendor. Mr. Raja is also known for his erudition in the matter of writing a lot of journals and articles in law journals and newspapers like The Hindu, The Times of India, and The Indian Express. The credentials and the feather in the caps of Raja, Mr. Raja, are umpteen and innumerable. And let me have the pleasure of inviting Mr. Raja to commence his webinar on the working of the commercial courts in India. So Raja sir, please, you can commence.
Yeah. Good morning, friends. I must thank SSR Law Associates and Hemlata for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts with a very with regard to a very important legislation, which is the Commercial Courts Act. Thankfully, now it exists in its abridged form. Earlier, it was the Commercial Courts, Commercial Divisions, Commercial Appellate Divisions. It was actually contesting for the longest title to an Act Award. But thankfully, after the 2018 amendments, it has now been shortened to the Commercial Courts Act. Now, before I start my presentation, there are a lot of youngsters who are, I understand, attending this webinar presentation. My request to you is, kindly have a scribble pad or a small pad in which you note down every day what you see around you. The greatest, next to the power of persuasion which an advocate should have, one of the greatest gifts he can have is his power of observation. So when, as soon as I joined my office, it was a tradition in our office. And as soon as we joined the office, my senior Mr. Govind Swaminathan would give every junior a memo pad. The utility of this memo pad was twofold. it was first to jot down all instructions he gave us to be done that day or the next day or the following day or in the near future. And secondly, it was to enable us to observe what was happening in courts, any interesting case laws that were cited by any of the advocates, even in cases where the particular advocate is not appearing, or any interesting observations that fell from the court. These were to be jotted in that memo pad, and that was a very, very useful device. So my request to all the youngsters who are participating in this webinar is, please make a point of carrying these memo pads, scribble notepads, whatever you call them. And at the end of the day, please look at what are the takeaways from a day. A takeaway is really just not what you order in a restaurant and take away after you finish a meal, or you order in Swiggy, or go to a restaurant and pick up stuff. It is what you take away from your professional life at the end of a day. So kindly please make a note of this, a bit of a gratuitous advice that I'm giving you, because it has served me in good stead. I'm sure that it will serve you all also in good stead if you follow this. Now, coming to the Commercial Courts Act, the Commercial Courts Act 2015 is a law still in its infancy. So hopefully, all of us, if we collectively endeavor, we would be in a position to take this infant through proper stages of development and hope that it will develop into a useful legislation which will serve society. Which is what every citizen has to do, isn't it? That every child must grow up to be a useful citizen. Like that, let's hope that we all put in our collective endeavors to see that this infant legislation grows up into a proper and responsible statute. Now, why is an act of this nature necessary? That I'm going, and the question and answers and sessions, I'm sure that you're going to all come with a barrage of questions as to why this act is necessary at all. We already have a CPC. If CPC can't perform, are these courts going to perform? All this, let me come to that eventually. But let us briefly look at, I am fascinated by history, and I also think that a person who does not know the reason behind the law does not know the law. So when you start going into the reason behind the law, you also land up with trying to educate yourself on a bit of history with what led to that legislation, why did we have a legislation like this, and the famous mischief rule. What is the mischief that act was supposed to rectify? All these are important questions that arise for consideration, and I'll come to that. Therefore, the history, let's look at why an act like this was necessary. Traditionally, in Europe, you had this law which is called the Lei Mercatoria. Lei Mercatoria was the law that was applicable to merchants. It contained mercantile usages. Most importantly, it provided a facility for adjudication of disputes within a very short period of time. In Europe, in medieval Europe, the four major cities or more four major centers of commerce were Venice, Genoa, Barcelona, and Amsterdam. So to be a merchant of Venice is to hold a very high position in society. That's why Shakespeare called one of his plays The Merchant of Venice, because a merchant of Venice was a very respectable person in society, and he went by his word. That's why you had this pound of flesh argument in Merchant of Venice, because a merchant of Venice would act by his word. So that is the way that the law of Lei Mercatoria, as we called it, evolved over a period of time. Importantly, the simplicity of the procedure involved and justice, rendering justice according to equity and good conscience came to be the yardsticks by which these courts would function. And as we went along and as we developed, many of these principles you will see finds reflection even in provisions of recent legislations. For example, the Arbitration Conciliation Act, Section 28, talks about trade usage. It also talks about lec aqua et bono, which is really deciding a case on the basis of equity and good conscience. So these are principles which flow from medieval Europe right up to the present day. So primarily the advantage of a commercial court was that these decisions must be rendered within the quickest time possible. There was a reason behind this. Many of the mercantile trade in medieval Europe was very closely related to maritime trade. So many times when a ship docked at a harbor and dispatched goods, there would be disputes that would arise. But these disputes had to be resolved within a quick period of time, Namely, by the time the ship left this port and went to the other port, it had to be resolved. So many times they had to be resolved in the same day. So it is just not possible for you to have a system where you file a plane, then you file additional documents, then you file an additional plane, then you file amendment to a plaint application, then you file a written statement, and then you amend your written statement, and then you file your list of witnesses, then add to that list of witnesses, then you file a list of documents, and then realize the most important document has not been furnished. So the traditional systems did not, the traditional systems could just not apply to late Mercatoria. So they evolved a field of law where matters came to be decided, as I told you earlier, under justice, equity, and good conscience. So the primary fundamental advantage in a commercial court was that it led to resolution of disputes within a short period of time. Now, that gave a huge advantage to the merchants from Europe. Now, in India, traditionally, we had this very interesting system called Srinis, S-H-R-E-N-I. Please log in and read about Srinis. They were an amazing guild of merchants which existed in India from 5th century BC. The guild of merchants would ensure that financial transactions were financed, recovery of amounts due were facilitated. Importantly, they would even protect the intellectual property of artisans and skilled craftsmen. So this was a wonderful system which existed in ancient India, which ensured that through generations, we acquired an ascendancy in the manner we did commerce. This existed till the British came to India, and this led to a system. And even in South India, there were these guilds of merchants, which did excellent work. And in fact, the interesting aspect about the guilds in South India is they were also negotiating with temples, for temples to loan their monies to the merchants at a specified rate of interest. There are inscriptions of the Chola period which shows that merchants used to borrow money from temples at 12% interest. And that's why over a period of time, in respect of certain mercantile community, settling loans became almost a divine obligation. And that continued even after they stopped taking money from temples, but from other people. So, you know, therefore, all this led to a phenomenal culture of doing commerce within the four corners of law. This led to a situation where in 1800, India's contribution to GDP, to the world GDP, was 23%, a whopping 23%. And between India and China, we financed 50% of the world's, we had a share of 50% of the world's GDP. Compare this with the situation when the British left us in 1947, it was a meager 2%. So we fell from a phenomenal level of 23% of the world's GDP to just having a 2% share in the world's GDP. Why did this happen? This happened because many of those merchants who existed in earlier times were fabulously rich. In fact, once again, you can Google details relating to a merchant called Jagat Seth, who lived in the 18th century. He financed the Mughal emperor. The Mughal emperor was the most affluent and one of the most dazzlingly rich emperors in the world. But Jagat Seth financed the Mughal emperor. And he also, interestingly, financed the East India Company. He financed Robert Clive to fight the Battle of Plassey. So these merchants, and therefore, interestingly, one aspect which I would like to draw your attention to, ancient India and even medieval India never allowed sovereignty and the commercial world to overlap. The king did his best. He governed, right? And there was a commercial world which did commerce. So they never allowed these to overlap. For the first time, it was only after the East India Company came in that there was an overlap between sovereignty and commercial and the commercial world, because the commercial merchants doubled as rulers. The East India Company was only a merchant. They did not come here with any ambitions to be territorial sovereigns, but they ended up being territorial sovereigns. And then in 1857, when Britain, the British Parliament took over the rule of India, that persisted. So one of the first legislations that the British Parliament brought in to protect the interest of merchants was the Indian Contract Act, the Sale of Goods Act, the Specific Relief Act, etc., etc. If you look at these acts, there is one very, very interesting aspect, and that was that even if you had a 100% good case in contract, in specific performance, there was still a discretion in the court to grant you that relief or not to grant you that relief. The purpose behind this, this was changed only recently by a 2018 amendment. The Specific Relief Act says that the court has no discretion in awarding contracts. I'm sure one of the earlier speakers must have dealt with it in greater detail. I think Mr. Patsa, the senior counsel, has dealt with it in greater detail. That, you know, these were amendments that were brought in 2018, which now removes the discretion of the court in granting specific performance of the contract. But the reason behind that is the sovereign had fused his functions with that of a merchant when the British came in as rulers. Sadly, after 1947, we continued that line till in 1991, our economy changed, and we allowed more and more supremacy for the mercantile world to operate and for the government to start receiving. So this is a basic history of how this commercial law developed, what was its status, what was its application. Now let us come to why we needed a change in the scenario. Just before 2003, there were very many courts in very many parts of the world which were saying that Indian courts are not highly developed, highly evolved legal regimes. And they were appropriating themselves, this argument of just convenience, they were appropriating themselves jurisdiction over matters which really the jurisdiction must have been with India. So once this happened, the Law Commission of India reacted to the situation by drafting a Commercial Courts Act, where it says that this is highly deplorable. Our legal system is not being respected in other parts of the world, and therefore we need to bring in something to rectify the situation. So in 2003, they brought in this, the Law Commission report on the Commercial Courts Act. In 2009, in India, all this takes a lot of time to travel from idea to reality. So in 2009, there was a bill that was drafted to give effect to the ideas that had been put in place by the Law Commission. Now that bill was met with strong opposition, both by all the opposition parties, primarily the present ruling party and the left parties. And they said that you are creating a five-star culture on account of this. Where is the presence of these courts at grassroots levels? You are trying to transform and park all the litigations in the High Court. The High Court is already an overburdened institution, and you want to now transfer everything to the High Court. This is not a very bright idea. The matter was referred to a select committee. Nothing much came out of it. Now, after the present dispensation came to power in 2015, they wanted to bring in real changes to the legal regime. So one of the things that they did, besides the IBC, besides the amendment to the Arbitration Conciliation Act, etc., etc., they also asked the Law Commission to come up with a bill which will take care of commercial issues and an institution which will dispose of commercial matters within a given time frame, and most importantly, to usher in a completely new legal culture. That's a very, very important, because please understand that these commercial courts are going to be the test tube for a revolution in the manner in which we handle all civil litigation. It is not going to stop with this. Therefore, much depends upon its success, and all of us have a collective interest to make it work, because if this model works, that is then going to be transposed to our legal system, because our legal culture does not respect timelines. We keep on, and very sadly in the Salem Bar Association case, the Supreme Court said that these timelines are merely directory and not mandatory. This allows an entrenched system which does not respect timelines, and we do not move towards time-bound disposal of matters before courts. Therefore, we must understand this is a very bold experiment, and we must ensure as advocates, as judges, or in whatever in whatever form, in whatever manner we come in touch with the system, we must ensure that this system works. Now, therefore, this commercial courts, commercial division, commercial appellate divisions act came into effect in 2015. Primarily, for the first time, possibly, India took a serious look at commercial history. In fact, interestingly, please read the judgment of the Supreme Court in LIC versus Escorts. The first three pages, Justice Chinnappa Reddy says that these commercial matters should not come to court at all. And when the court has much more serious issues to be handled, that these commercial matters are unnecessarily clogging the time of the court. This was attitudes, both government and judicial attitude to commercial disputes. And therefore, court said that we have to concentrate on more serious aspects of governance and not on commercial. Thankfully, in 2015, you have a legislation which says that no, we will take commercial disputes seriously. So what does this act do? What is the primary purpose of this act? And as I said, you are all going to come back to me with questions of why must there be an amendment to the CPT? All this is there, is all new wine and old bottle? Possibly yes, but I will come to that a little later. First is this act defines commercial disputes, or rather delineates commercial disputes. It talks about 22 classes of commercial disputes in Section 2. Now, what is interesting is that this is an exhaustive definition. That is, you can't call a particular dispute as a commercial dispute and take it to this court unless it falls within 21 of these categories. The 22nd category is where the central government feels that any of these disputes must be taken, classified as a commercial dispute. Power is given in the 22nd clause for the central government to classify any dispute as a commercial dispute. So the first aspect that you have to understand is that the definition of commercial dispute under the Act is an exhaustive definition which takes care of 22 categories of disputes. The second is the constitution of specialized courts and division. Now, there is a bit, I will dwell on it in a little greater detail. There are currently, today, I'm not talking about the time when the Act was constituted in 2015, was enacted in 2015. I'm talking about the current situation. There are four types of courts that have to be constituted under the Act. The question mark is, have all these courts been constituted? No. And is it right in the manner in which they have been constituted? No, I'll come to this a little later. But there are four types of courts that have to be established under the code. One, commercial court at a district court level. Commercial court below a district court level. Commercial division in high courts that have original jurisdiction. There are only five courts in India which have original jurisdiction. They are Madras, Bombay, Calcutta, Delhi, and Himachal Pradesh. Only five courts in the country have original side jurisdiction. So commercial divisions established in these courts, then commercial appellate division. This is the hierarchy of courts under the commercial courts. Now various governments, the commercial courts below the district court level came with the 2018 amendment, but have not been constituted or appointed by the government in several places across the country. I'll come to why it was necessary to amend it. Primarily, the reason for bringing out the Commercial Courts Act is that India wanted to improve its ranking on two world parameters. One is the ease of doing business, and the second is enforcement of contracts. These were two international parameters on the basis of which the World Bank ranked many countries. So India wanted to improve its ranking. Therefore, it brought out the commercial courts. So there are other reasons which it talks about, but primarily this is reason why it brought out the 2015 Act. While that is laudable, one aspect which India failed to note when it brought out the Act in 2015 is how does the World Bank do its ranking? The World Bank was doing its ranking on the basis, as far as India is concerned, on the basis of how commercial disputes were handled in the district courts at Bombay and Delhi. It is only these two regions which the World Bank was taking up for consideration. It was not taking up the other regions for consideration. But since these two courts had commercial divisions, there were no commercial cases filed in the district courts at all. So on what use would with the Commercial Courts Act yield if you are not going to have commercial courts at the district level? It is to plug this hiatus in the act. There was an amendment passed in 2018, which now said that there shall be a commercial court at the district court and below the district court level, because the World Bank parameters would not only examine the functioning of a court, but also as an appellate court. So what happens now, if you file a case, now hopefully much of it has not been has been operationalized, but primarily the hope is that any commercial claims between 3 lakhs and 1 crore will be filed in the court which is below the district court, which is a commercial court which is below the district court, and an appeal from that would lie to the district court. From the district court, which is equivalent, which is a commercial court at the level of a district court, any order that is passed would go directly to a commercial division bench at the High Court. From any order that is passed in the commercial division, an appeal will go to the commercial division bench. The unique feature of this act is it does not provide for more than one appeal in any class of cases that are taken up as commercial causes and as commercial disputes. Therefore, you must remember that there is only one facility of appeal that is contemplated under the provisions of this act. Then the third is there are procedural changes which the act has brought. Once again, this is a question where I'm going to be asked, so what is so different about discovery of documents? What is so different about inspection of documents? All this is already in the CPC. But the point is that all this is made time bound under the provisions of the Commercial Courts Act. Therefore, time bound proceedings under the provisions of the Commercial Courts Act is the third most important aspect. The fourth is what I had told you earlier, limited appeals. There is only one appeal that has been provided. So if you ask me to identify the backbone of this act, it is these four features. Now, on the basis of this, let us look at a few provisions of the act very quickly, because this act is not a 160 section act or 180 section act. It just has 23 sections, and therefore it will be easy for us to quickly understand what these provisions mean. Section 2, as I said, deals with definitions. Section 3 deals with the constitution of commercial courts. And then 3A has been introduced by the 2018 amendment, which talks about designation of commercial appellate courts. Fourth is constitution of commercial division of the High Court. Fifth is constitution of commercial appellate division. What are the powers of that appellate court? Sixth is jurisdiction of a commercial court in respect of what disputes, in what manner would the court have jurisdiction over these 21 classes of disputes is what it talks about. Then section 28 is bar against revision application or petition. All of you, especially those from the Universal Court, know that the moment a suit is filed, in fact, my senior used to tell me in those days, the maximum number of civil revision petitions would come from areas where the literacy was very high. So Kanyakumari district, one suit that is filed will see at least 50 CRPs. Any order that is passed by the court will immediately land up by way of a CRP before the court. And therefore, you would have at least 50 CRPs filed before a suit comes to a finality. The districts in which there are lower levels of literacy, you will see more criminal cases there, because there people don't spend time negotiating or talking. It is direct action. So you will have maximum number of criminal cases come from districts, which is a very interesting study. He was part of the study which was then made, and therefore there would be high incidence of criminal cases from those jurisdictions. So therefore, the Commercial Courts Act, there is a bar against the number of there is bar against revision applications being filed against orders. So whatever it is, if an order is passed by a commercial court, you will have to take it only as part of your final appeal proceedings, and you can't keep rushing to the High Court in Himachal Pradesh and Delhi, as they say, even if a matter is urgent, they'll go to the Supreme Court. Because geographical proximity, you will go to the Supreme Court. In Tamil Nadu, it doesn't happen. Actually, in respect of the Supreme Court, it's only 1.2% of all the cases. A very interesting study done by a scholar, a Harvard scholar, Mark Robbins. You must download it and read it. It's very interesting. But only 1.2% of all the cases pending in the Supreme Court are from Tamil Nadu. 12% of all the cases pending in Supreme Court are from Delhi. Himachal Pradesh, which doesn't have even a fraction of the type of commercial activity that we have, 4% of all the cases pending in the Supreme Court are from Himachal Pradesh. So there is this geographical proximity, which is also an aspect of access to justice. And if you look at that, the creation of the Madurai bench is very laudable because it creates a geographical proximity to litigants to approach the courts. Therefore, now under Section 8, there is a bar against revision application or petitions to be filed before the commercial division of the High Court or even 227. Hopefully, the High Courts must rein in their powers, must exercise discipline, must say that we will not exercise our powers even under Article 227. But really, you can't by a statute exclude powers under 227 or 226, but it is only the inherent discipline of the court which must prevail, and the court must say that we will not interfere from orders of commercial courts, even under Article 227. And the court may possibly observe that all these matters, the party is left free to agitate it in appeal. But once the court start interfering in 227, that is the end. That's why I said all of us, the judiciary, the lawyers, the litigants, all of us have a collective responsibility for the upbringing of this infant called the Commercial Courts Act, and in discharging their function, possibly the High Court, in exercise under its powers under Article 227, must ensure that they necessarily do not interfere with any interim order that is being passed by these courts. Then Section 9 has been deleted. Section 9 said that if I file a claim for 10 lakhs and the where the jurisdiction was 1 crore earlier, if I file a claim for 10 lakhs and the other side files a counterclaim for 1 crore, then the matter gets transferred to the commercial court because the total value of the suit is 1 crore 10 lakhs. Now, that was unnecessary after the amendment reducing the jurisdiction of the courts to 3 lakhs came into effect. Because in any case, most of these matters, even if you buy a Maruti Desire Swift cars, you have a problem with that, it is going to come to the commercial courts for adjudication. Therefore, it was found that it was not necessary. Therefore, Section 9 has now been omitted. So you can omit Section 9. If you still have an old act, you can omit Section 9 because it's no longer in the statute book. Section 10 says that there is delineates the jurisdiction of these courts in respect of arbitration matters. And says in respect of Section 9 application or interim relief, even in respect of commercial dispute, international disputes, it will come only before the commercial division. It will not go to the various district courts. But in respect of other matters, it says that the jurisdiction will be with the district courts. Now, Section 11 is the bar of jurisdiction. One important aspect is, if in a commercial court or disputes arising under some other commercial transaction are addressed by a separate act, then even though that particular disputes fall under the classification of a commercial dispute, commercial courts will not have jurisdiction. One perfect example is the Chit Funds Act. Possibly all the transactions that fall under the Chit Funds Act can be classified as a commercial dispute. Still, if there is a separate forum, a separate procedure, a separate manner of adjudication of these disputes, then the jurisdiction would only be with the authority constituted under the Chit Funds Act. Importantly, in commercial dispute, I should have told you that even earlier, but the definition of a commercial dispute, even if it relates to land, the jurisdiction of the commercial court is not excluded. Or even in respect of a commercial transaction where land is offered as a security, the jurisdiction of commercial courts is not excluded. Importantly, the government transactions with the government are not excluded from the purview of the commercial court. So these are very salutary obligations under the provisions of the Commercial Courts Act, which have been brought in. I should have mentioned it when I talked about the definition clause of commercial disputes. So now under the Chit Funds Act, some property is offered as security, some loan is taken. So which aspect, if there is a particular commercial aspect that is covered by the Chit Funds Act, then that stands excluded. But if there is a part of the transaction which is not contemplated to be a dispute under the Chit Funds Act, then the commercial courts will still have jurisdiction. I was appointed as an amicus curiae on this issue. So I had to sort of delineate how this act works, especially in respect of section 11. Section 12 talks about determination of specified value. You may say that the determination of specified value has now become quite insignificant, because if every court is going to have jurisdiction over 3 lakhs and most, then there may not be many disputes with regard to whether, because two qualifications has to be satisfied. One is it must be a commercial dispute. Secondly, it must be about the specified value. So if at all there is going to be a dispute before a commercial court as to jurisdiction, it is going to be as to whether this is a commercial dispute, or it is going to be, this is not of the specified value. But the amendment in 2018 has taken care of the second concern, that most disputes will now come within the commercial. But in any case, section 12 sets out how the value has to be determined. When you, for example, if you file a suit, you seek for money decree, you ask for interest, the money principal plus the interest as on date of filing the suit will be the value to determine whether it is a commercial dispute. Likewise, section 12 is quite elaborate as far as that is concerned, but to my mind, it has become insignificant now on account of deletion of section 9 and the amendments that were brought in 2018. Section 12A prescribes for mediation and settlement. Now, this again is a four. This says if a suit is filed and in that suit you don't require interim relief, then that suit can be mediated. And it once again refers this to the authorities and to the Legal Services Act for mediation. Here I have a bit of a uneasiness with the manner in which this system can work. Why does alternate dispute resolution system not work in India? What is alternate about an alternate dispute resolution system? It is alternate to the traditional court. It is an alternate to the conventional courts. It is alternate to the general manner in which disputes have to be decided, isn't it? Call something alternate, and if the government and judiciary keep having control over that system also, then what is it an alternate to? This is the problem why alternate dispute resolution doesn't work in the country, because we call it alternate system. You have Legal Services Authority attached mediation centers. You have court attached mediation centers. You have government authorities attached mediation centers. You have court attached arbitration centers. You have government bodies like the NHAA come up with the Sarod system where they have their own system of settling dispute. So if you call all this alternate and still the government and the court want control over these bodies, then you will never have alternate dispute resolution in this country at all. So I have some manner of uneasiness with the manner in which it is a very laudable thought. Let me tell you that if at all it should work in a country, it should work in India, because the founder of the nation was a great champion of the mediation. And look at how many issues he has mediated. He has mediated within the community and within within religious sectors, the very bad way in which Harijans were treated. He has, through the constitution, given them status. He has mediated disputes between the British Raj and the Indians, and had managed to get the British to leave without a war being fought. So it is just not, everybody talks about Gandhi's contribution in South Africa to mediation. To my mind, his entire life was a commentary on the way in which mediation could be applied to different situations. But why it worked was he was not controlled by either the government or the courts in the manner of exercise of his duty. So you have to repose faith in institutions which can work in this way and be truly alternate dispute. You recognize them, you de-recognize them, you do whatever you want, but you can't say I will control them. The manner you start controlling institutions and call them alternate dispute resolutions, there is really nothing alternate to them at all. So I have a bit of an unease with this Section 12A, laudable, no doubt, but the manner in which it's going to be implemented, I don't think it is going to provide any great hope for any success. Section 13 provides for appeals. Now, Section 13, once again, it gives me a slight cause for unease. If you say, if you take Section 13 of the Act, it provides for appeals, but it uses two words there, because I had occasion to appear in two matters in which this provision was actually discussed threadbare. One is the Rubinitari Bresciani company relating to an Italian firm, and the other is with regard to magic frames. So these are the two case laws which you can possibly go and look at. It says that an appeal shall lie from a judgment or an order. I could have understood it, and orders are those that are mentioned in Order 43 of the Code of Civil Procedure related to Section 104 of the Code of Civil Procedure. Now, what is a judgment? Judgment is not a term that is defined under the Commercial Courts Act, but judgment is defined under CPC. Judgment under CPC is the reasons which the court gives for a decision. Order is exhaustive, it is specified under Order 43. So if an appeal lies under a judgment or under an order, what is the guide with regard to what a judgment is? The celebrated judgment of the Supreme Court in Shah Babulal Khimji's case. Shah Babulal Khimji case in 1981 is a brilliantly written judgment where the Supreme Court says that even if it is an order passed in an interim matter, still if it determines any rights or liabilities of a party finally, then an appeal will like this was actually interpretation of the word judgment under the letters patent appeal of the Bombay High Court. But still, if that word judgment is used, and the definition of judgment in the CPC doesn't help very much at all, because it only says it is the reason which the court gives for the decision, then the question arises against what is if a matter has been decided, and if it decides certain rights of the parties, and those rights of the parties are significant. In Babulal Khimji's case, the High Court, the Supreme Court lists out a whole range of orders which possibly will not fall under Order 43, but will still qualify as judgments. Therefore, in respect of those cases, would still an appeal be maintainable under the provisions of the Commercial Courts Act under Section 30. In fact, a very novel argument was taken before the Supreme Court in the Kandla Corporation case also. There, the argument was that Section 50 of the Arbitration Act does not, that is, in respect of a foreign decree, you can file an application to set aside that. If that application is allowed, there is no appeal. If the application is allowed, that is, if it is set aside, there is an appeal. If that application is dismissed, which means it says that that award can be executed, then there is no appeal. Now, a novel argument was taken before the Supreme Court, which says that even though Section 50 does bars an appeal, since under Section 13, an appeal has been recognized, an appeal will lie under the provisions of the Commercial Courts Act. The Supreme Court shot down that argument and said that it applied this classical principle of interpretation, which is when there is a general legislation and when there is a particular legislation, the general legislation must always yield to that particular legislation. It said that the Arbitration Act and the Code of Civil Procedure, in its ultimate effect, Commercial Courts Act, are only amending the CPC. Therefore, CPC is a general provision. As against this, Arbitration Act is a special provision. Therefore, the provisions of the Special Act will prevail over the general provisions of the CPC. So, by applying this concept of interpretation of statutes, the court said that no appeal will lie under Section 30. But it is my earnest belief that at the second or the next round of this amendment of the Act, possibly you will have to substitute the word judgment with the decree, because otherwise it may lead to a situation where there are going to be a whole lot of appeals that are going to be filed against orders, which still will cause it to qualify as judgments under the letters patent. Because leave alone letters patent, no, you have to go by the judgment of judgment in Babulal Khimji. So if you apply that, then possibly an appeal may lie, which is a situation we may have to live with unless some clarity emerges from the legislature. Then section 14 talks about expeditious disposal of appeals. One aspect I must mention is, though section 15, I'm going to come to that, talks about transfer of pending cases, there is no provision for transferring an appeal. Even though it is a appeal of the commercial courts, those appeals don't get transferred to the commercial division. They will still be dealt with only by the traditional courts. This, once again, I think is an aspect which needs to be amended, because I see no rationale why these appeals should not be transferred to the commercial division bench of the High Court. If suits are going to be transferred, I think the appeals also must be transferred to the appellate benches. But as of now, as the provision stands, appeals are not transferred. It is only suits that are transferred. Now, section 15 of the Act talks about transfer of pending cases. So all cases which have been instituted and are pending before various courts and which can be classified as commercial disputes, the registry has done a wonderful work, starting from the district court level to the high court level, all of them have been transferred. There are obviously arguments that may arise. Some matters are posted for maintainability. Some arguments has to be heard as to whether they are commercial disputes. And if they are commercial disputes, then they are sent to the regular. But one aspect which is quite amusing for me is, it really doesn't make a difference at all as things stand now. What was, I was a consulting, this is when this Law Commission report came up with this Commercial Courts Act. So we had some very interesting discussions with one of the things that AP Shah said, which is very, very relevant, was he said that not all districts in the country are going to have that many number of commercial cases. Right? For example, northeastern states, Manipur possibly has no commercial cases at all. Many of these, Mizoram, all these states possibly may not have commercial cases as disputes as defined under the provisions of the commercial courts. Therefore, to say that special courts must be established in all these jurisdictions would be an enormous wasteful expenditure for the government. So what the Law Commission suggested was, in respect of there is a power given to the High Court and to the government to designate existing district courts as commercial courts. This was a facility which was supposed to be applied as an exception in cases where courts don't have enough number of commercial causes. Unfortunately, what has happened, take Tamil Nadu for example, there are 32 districts and some, I don't know, 28 district courts or whatever. There is not a single commercial court that has been established at all. All that we have done is we have designated existing district courts as commercial courts. This completely defeats the purpose of the Act, completely. There is, because I don't know how many of you, I'm sure quite a lot of you who are listening into this conversation, have visited a district court. That poor gentleman, the principal district judge, what are all the type of cases that he has to deal with? The morning bail petitions, then trial and MACTOP cases, matrimonial cases, appeal cases, statutory appeals. You know, his workload is stupendous. In addition to that, he has to work as an administrative officer and do an administration of all the courts in the various taluks within the district. So to actually entrust him with the power of a district court is quite amusing, because you are not going to see any change at all. It is really old wine in new bottle. What must the court therefore do? All high courts must try and make an analysis of how many commercial litigations, commercial disputes are pending in various districts. In those districts where they are sizable, separate district commercial courts must be established, and also the commercial court below the district level must be established in those districts. This is not a difficult exercise at all, but this exercise has to be done. Unfortunately, it has not been done. And unless it is done, this commercial court will continue to remain in paper. Because if we are going to look at a time-bound proceeding before a district judge who is saddled with enormous responsibilities, let us face it, it is not going to happen. So this infant, actually, which we are talking about, if this is not done, it is going to regress into a stillborn baby, right? So it is our collective hope that it does not regress to a situation of being a stillborn baby, and therefore we have done. I'll come to it in the end as to how a group of lawyers all over India have got together and formed an association, and we are pushing for these reforms to happen. But that's besides the point. The point is that this unfortunately has not happened, and today. And whenever statistics are being talked about, the Tamil Nadu government says we have not established, you only issued a notification by which you have already, there is already a district judge, and to the district judge you have given him powers to operate as a commercial court. This is not what the Act contemplates. This is not what Justice A.P. Shah had in mind when he submitted the report to of the commercial court. So we need a complete change in the manner in which this Act has been implemented. Because I'm going to talk to you about the various timeframes that are going to be that are being set out in the Act, and if these timeframes are to have any meaning at all, we must have separate commercial courts, at least in the district which sees, because Tamil Nadu is number two in India's economy after Maharashtra. It is the most affluent state, and it churns out the maximum number of commercial issues. And today, what is happening? I'll come to the other manner in which today there is only one high court which I would rank as being completely in compliance with the provisions of the Commercial Courts Act, or at least largely in compliance with the Commercial Courts Act, and that is the Delhi High Court. Delhi High Court has even recently allowed a public interest litigation and directed 22 commercial courts below the district court level and the district court level also to be constituted by the government. Therefore, we must do it with that level of sincerity, determination, and purpose. Otherwise, it will not work. Section 16 of the Act specifies very clearly that the rules, the amended provisions of this Act, will supersede the rules made under any other law, which means that under the letters patent law. Many of the practitioners on the original side will know that previously the law was that the rules of the High Court will prevail over the rules of the CPC, but that is no longer good law in respect of commercial courts. The provisions of the Commercial Courts Act will prevail by a very specifically enacted provision. Section 16 talks about the letters patent also, and it will prevail over the provisions of even the letters patent. Section 17 is a very interesting provision. It talks about collection and disclosure of data, that every high court every month has to display on its website the number of cases filed before the commercial courts below the district level, commercial division, commercial appellate division. It must also give statistics of number of cases that have been disposed. Please go into the net and look up commercial courts statistical data rules. There is a rule which has been prepared for this purpose, and that rule has to be complied with. Even the format in which this information should appear in the website of the High Court has been stated. Only 8 high courts in the country have complied with this. Unfortunately, Madras High Court has not complied with this provision. Only 8 high courts across the country have complied with it. Only Delhi High Court gives a monthly report of the pendency of cases and disposal of cases. Even Bombay does not give a monthly report of a pendency of cases, at least till the last that I looked up. Daily, the monthly report of the pendency of cases have not been. This is a very, very, very significant provision of the Act, and we must all work towards ensuring that it is implemented. Because as they say, there is no greater disinfectant than the sunlight. I'm sorry that I'm talking to about you about disinfectant in the times of coronavirus, but you know, in the ultimate analysis, the best disinfectant is sunlight. Be as transparent as possible. So if you are to be transparent as possible, these statistics must appear on the website of the High Court. They do not appear. Out of the 24 high courts, only 8 high courts, it appears there is a provision made, but even in these high courts, except Delhi High Court, no high court has displayed the statistics as they are required to be displayed under the provisions of the Act. Then section 18 is an important provision in regard to practice directions to be issued by the High Court. Here I must say that Madras High Court has come up with some very good practice directions, which that is also available in the website. It is available in the website of the Madras High Court itself. The practice directions delineate the powers of this court and the manner in which the powers should be exercised. There Madras High Court has done an excellent job on these practice directions. This again is a collective responsibility of all of us. As we go along, as we practice this litigation, the moment we come up with any hitches, the moment we come up with the stumbling blocks, it is our duty to inform the registrar of the High Court that these additions, modifications, amendments to the practice directions issued by the High Court must be made. That's our responsibility, because you can't expect the registrar, you can't expect the judges to know about every possible stumbling block in the implementation. There might be some problems with regard to interpretation. All this must form part of the practice directions that are to be issued by the High Court, and we must all cooperate to make this happen. And then section 19 talks about infrastructural facilities that the government has to provide, and section 20 talks about training and education of the officers. These once again are provisions which are observed only in the breach. We don't have the commercial courts must be set up with the latest technological infrastructure. There must be provision for legal transcription. There must be provision for recording the evidence of the witnesses. All this must be available in a drop-down screen. You must be able to read it, and there must be a provision for immediate issuance of the orders that have been passed by the court. All these infrastructural facilities have to be set up. But since we have not created exclusive commercial courts, nobody is thinking about creating these infrastructural facilities at all. So we need to create infrastructural facilities. We need to house these infrastructural facilities, or rather improve these infrastructural facilities on a constant basis with the latest infusion of technology. Unfortunately, that is also not happening. Section 21 is an overriding effect, that the provisions of this Act will override any other Act in respect of the matters dealt with under the provisions of the Act. Then section 21A talks about the power of the central government to make rules. These are the usual provisions that you will find in all acts. Section 22 talks about the power of the power to remove difficulties, and section 23 talks about repeals and savings. So that is the provision of the Act. Then it provides for a schedule, and in the schedule it talks about various timelines that are to be followed in the implementation of the Act. I will quickly take you through those time frames which are important, and then probably we'll go to the question and answer session. The after the plaint is filed, summons is served, and then the written arguments have to be filed within a period of 30 days, extendable to 120 days. In a recent judgment of the Supreme Court passed in 2019, Supreme Court has said that these are inflexible timelines. Thank God they didn't do what they did in Salem Bar Association case and said that all these are merely directory. In one fell swoop, they would have finished off that Act, but thankfully the Supreme Court said that these are rigid timeframes which have to be respected. And then the court has to decide a claim. There is a very important provision which has been provided in Order 13. For a long time within the High Court's jurisdiction, the Civil Court's jurisdiction, summary proceedings meant that you could get a summary disposal of the case and a decree on the basis of what is stated in the plea. You never had a facility of dismissing a suit because it did not disclose a cause of action. Right, Order 7, Rule 11 applications could be taken for rejection of a plea, but that was sort of restricted to the ground stated in Order 7, Rule 11. But under the provisions of the summary proceedings of the present Act, there is a wide jurisdiction given to the court to dismiss a suit if it finds that the suit was deficient on any ground. Recording of evidence has to be carried out on a day-to-day basis, which is provided under Order 15A(4). Very importantly, there is a provision for case management. This business of case management, only those of us who have read John Grisham's novels would have heard of this business of case management. It is alien to India's legal culture. But the case management is a very important aspect and it is possibly the entire crux of the Commercial Courts Act. And as soon as pleadings are completed, the matter is posted before the court, and the court then comes up with various timelines within which various things that have to be done in respect of the legislation are done. What are these that have to be done? Framing of issues, listing of witnesses to be examined by the parties, fixing the date by which affidavits of evidence are to be filed by the parties, fix the dates in which the evidence of witnesses are to be recorded, fixing the dates by which written arguments are to be filed before the court by the parties, fixing the dates by which the oral arguments are to be heard by the court, setting timelines for parties to address the courts. All this is time. We are trying to become like the American Supreme Court. You heard of the concept of swish of the silk in the American Supreme Court. The American Supreme Court will give you 20 minutes to make your presentation, and the 9 judges will sit. The Supreme Court of America doesn't sit in benches. It's just all cases are heard by 9 judges of the Supreme Court. And within the 20 minutes, if you are not able to complete your arguments, and you may be looking down and reading the paper, you will just hear the swish of the silks as all the judges get up and leave. They will just depart I take your leave. Their entire court will vacate and it will go. So that is the type of time management we have to push ourselves to. And here again, all of us advocates have a role to play, that we stick to the timelines that have been given under the provisions of the Act. As I said, in summation, I should say that this is a very dynamic departure. And as I said, this is a test tube to see that we follow the same. If this works well, then we have hope that this will be replicated in the civil court also. This has been stated by the government, and the Law Commission also says that this must be achieved. It is very, very demeaning for us that courts all over the world are taking pot shots at the Indian judicial system. Here is a challenge for us to change and to see that we are also capable of and producing a system which will take our commerce back to the time we were in 1800 when we commanded 23% of the world's GDP. That is the direction towards which we should go. And this possibly is a vehicle which will take us there. This, in addition to the Arbitration Act, to the IBC, to the Debt Recovery Tribunal, everything put together, possibly will be the package that will take us there. I was talking to you about an All India Association. We have formed an All India Association. It is ICABA. We have a website for that. Please go into the website. I have sent a representation to all the 24 high courts and to the law ministries in all the 24 states to comply with the law as it stands. I have not received any reply from any government or from any high courts, but as soon as the courts come to some level of proper functioning, ICABA intends to move a public interest litigation before the Supreme Court. It is like how Mr. Shauri, H.E. Shauri, father of Mr. Arun Shauri, after the Consumer Protection Act was passed in 1989, it was also a stillborn baby. Nothing happened. And he moved the writ petition in the Supreme Court, and it is only pursuant to his, all the efforts that he took, that consumer courts were established all over the country and were made functional in the manner in which it is contemplated under the provisions of the Act. So that, therefore, there is a requirement for a push and to make this happen, which is not happening in many parts of the country. And it is our collective endeavor to see that this Act is applied in intent and in purpose. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Glad to take questions.
Thank you very much, sir. I have a personal question, sir. Though you have said that the Act is very self-contained code, has dealt with almost in finest details all the aspects of the law, though it has been made time-bound and though the Supreme Court has not diluted the time-bound thing, but one lacking feature, you find that there is no specific provision for the execution of the orders of the decree. That means we have to resort to the provisions of CPC under Order 21.
Yes.
Are right, sir?
Yes. because the provisions of the Commercial Courts Act make an amendment to the CPC. So those provision of CPC which remain unamended, you still have to go through the provisions of that act. And of course, execution is going to become easier business. It already is easier business in respect of companies and entities covered under the IPC, because even with the decree, you can now possibly move the IBC for winding up a company, and therefore execution becomes easier. And in respect of private individuals also, the IBC has been amended, but it has to be operationalized. But that part of it is going to go to the DRT, and the DRT will have jurisdiction to hear insolvency petitions. So your quicker route of execution, I don't think in the next, after 5 years, is ever going to be the civil court. There are people who are going to go to either the IBC or they are going to go to the DRT for execution of orders. But you are right.
Yes,
CPC still rules as far as execution of orders.
Execution.
Because provisions with regard to the schedule to the Commercial Act is a change to the schedule in the CPC.
Yes, sir. Second question, sir. Is there any writ petition pending before the High Court as to enforcement of the Act in stricto sensu in the matter in the state of Tamil Nadu, to your knowledge?
To my knowledge, not to my knowledge. But we are planning to file one in the Supreme Court to look at its enforcement all over the country.
Okay, sir. May I now request any Vijay sir to talk to you? He is waiting in the line. And Lord Shiv Anand Vengadesh, sir, you can talk to NL Raj.
Good morning, Judge.
Hello. Hello.
Good morning, Judge.
I just unmute him. Just a senior VJ. I think on your line, sir. So his line is muted. So may I open the session to the public, sir?
Yeah, please do.
Okay. So, Mr. Mayyappan, you can ask the question to Mr. Raja. Mr. Mayyappan?
Honorable Justices, respected Speaker and learned friends. Sir, it was a wonderful and enlightening session. Thank you. So my question is, you were mentioning that until the East India Company, there was no overlap of commerce and sovereignty. And since you are a man who was also associated with the PDS, I heard. Sir, is there a restriction or condition by the World Bank on the public distribution system in India? And if so, isn't that, you know, compromising on the sovereignty and the interests of our nation, sir?
I'm sorry, I didn't get your question. World Bank says what?
Is there some conditions and restrictions imposed by the World Bank regarding the public distribution system in India? That is, you know, the free rice and all that should not be given, something like that, in order to avail certain funds. Is there any restrictions of that sort?
I'm not really aware of that. I don't think so. These are all domestic matters. I don't think the World Bank will interfere in these issues, but I don't know. I don't know. I don't have that.
All right, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. May I request Mr. P. S. Subraman from Subraman, sir.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, sir.
Morning.
Sir, my question is, suppose if there is a dispute between two parties, between A and B, and the documents were executed prior to the Commercial Courts Act 2015, whether the cause of action is based on the dispute prior to 2015, whether such disputes comes under Commercial Courts Act or not. My first question. My second question is, under the, in the within the district court, whether the additional the court, the district judge is the notified judge as per the High Court notification, whether the additional district judge can try such commercial courts matter. Two questions.
See, as far as the cause of action is concerned, this act has a, you know, the general rule. The general rule is that all procedural laws will have retrospective operation unless the retrospective operation relates to a substantial right. So it will have, there are some, you know, developed, there is a body of case laws on what will be substantial rights, even in respect of procedural matters. But the general rule is that that these commercial courts have a retrospective operation and will apply to the cause of actions arising even before the act came into force. As far as additional judge, I've seen that the notification does not confer the additional judge. I may be wrong, and there might be subsequent notifications, but the notification I saw only conferred that right on the principal district judge. If there are any notifications that have come up subsequently, I am not aware.
Thank you.
May I request Mr. P.V.S. Giridhar to address this general Rajan. Mr. Giridhar.
Sorry, what do you want me to address on?
No, you have written something in the chat box. Can you address this to Mr. General Rajan? The question posed to Mr.
That is regarding the WTO.
Yes, sir, please, I can tell
you. No, sir. Somebody, one lawyer asked about whether World Bank scheme, World Bank has any control over our public distribution system. I just said that the World Trade Organization, which envisages free trade, free global trade, has certain rules. And United States, UK, and other European countries have criticized the Indian public distribution system, in particular our Food Security Act, on the ground that it distorts the market for agricultural products, because agricultural products are being supplied free or at very subsidized rates. They are arguing that American and European farmers are unable to participate in that market, and to that extent they are being prevented from access to the Indian food market. That is all I know about it. I'm not an expert, but this much I have read in the newspapers.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Any other questions from anybody? Can you raise your hands? Any questions? Mr. Henry Tiffin, you can talk to Mr. Raja behind.
Raja, good morning.
Good morning, Henry.
It was wonderful listening to you after a long time on a matter like this. Gained a lot of knowledge on commercial courts. I'm far away from commercial courts, so it was a very learning experience. And also your critical views on some parts of the Act, which you were kind enough to also mention. But I think I agree with you that if the implementation of this legislation is on the lines of the legislation we have per se, without it being burdensome to the existing district judges who are already overburdened, then the benefits of this legislation and will flow over to legal practice in general and the judiciary's qualitative improvement overall. I fully agree with you on that, and I hope we as members of the bar would be able to also contribute to that process, as you appealed several times in your lecture. Thank you very much, Raja. Thank you,
Henry. I couldn't have put it better. That's precisely the point that I'm trying to drive home. That, you know, in India, we have this strange phenomenon that an act as a noun is very easily achieved. Somebody, some problem, immediately you pass an act. That is an act as a noun. But act as a verb very rarely happens, or very shoddily happens. So for something to transform from an act to action becomes a great and a stupendous task in our legal system. So I think it must be our collective endeavor that this act also does not go the same way, because if it does, then the test tube experiment fails very badly, and it is not going to get transferred to the civil system of adjudication of justice. So thanks for those observations.
Thank you very